Welcome to Algebra 2. This is section 4.8, Analyzing Graphs of Polynomial Functions. All right. For our introduction, a turning point of a graph is a place where the graph changes from increasing to decreasing or vice versa. So I want you to pause the video, take a minute or so, and see if you can't approximate the coordinates of where each of the following functions have turning points. And I'll check back in a few seconds. All right, hopefully we have this introduction taken care of. Let's check our work. So the first one here, we notice a turning point. My function is increasing, and then it gets to this point, and then it starts decreasing. It starts losing height. Then it's decreasing for a while. It reaches this point, and then it starts increasing afterwards. So those two points are the turning points of that graph. Let's get rid of my ink so we can see that a little bit more clearly. And I would estimate, again, your answers could be slightly different. That's totally fine. I would estimate that this graph has turning points at negative 1/4, 1 and 1/4 maybe. So let's say 5/4. And then it would have another turning point right here. It looks like that's at 1 1/2. And then down 1 1/2. Again, we're just approximating. Okay, so for the second graph here, I would estimate that this turning point is taking place at negative 1 1/2. We're looking at this point down here, negative 6. It's just an approximation. Then the next point right here, I would say that would be 1/3 maybe. It's not quite 1/2. And then negative 2/3. And then the last turning point right here looks to take place at 1, negative 1. And for our last function, here we have this turning point, which I would say is negative 1, negative 1, just approximating. And the other turning point is up here. I would say that's 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and 2/3, 17/3. And, that's its height, 17/3. And it looks like the x value there is not quite 1, but it's really close to 1. And we're just approximating, so I'm going to say that's at 1/17. All right, and again, we're just approximating. You could have used decimals if you would have liked there, but I like improper fractions, and I think that if you're looking at moving to the next level, transitioning into the next level math student, that you should be more confident with improper fractions as well. They make work much easier, if you can believe that, when you get to higher level mathematics. All right, so here we start to bring all of our ideas about functions and all these polynomials we've covered so far this year. We try and bring those together. So zeros, factors, solutions, x-intercepts, they're all pretty much synonymous. They refer to the same type of point on a graph. So if we have a polynomial function, a zero, k is a zero of the polynomial function. All right, then a factor, the factor x minus k, and we usually see those written as a quantity in parentheses, it's a factor if k is a zero. Okay, we call k a solution or a root of the polynomial equation, the function equaling zero, having zero height. So we've seen the terms zero and solution kind of interchanged here. It just depends on the notation that we're given. And then lastly, an x-intercept. If k is a real number, then k is an x-intercept of the graph, and the graph passes through the point k, 0. So an x-intercept is what we're seeing graphically as a coordinate point, an ordered pair, where that graph actually crosses. So that is a very important slide, really, if you want to interpret what a question is asking you. That really kind of helps to explain the subtle little differences between those vocabulary words. Okay, lastly, the location principle. I should say lastly on this slide, if f is a polynomial function and a and b are two real numbers such that f of a, the height at point a, and f of b, the height at b, have opposite signs. In other words, one's a positive height, one's a negative height, then we know that f has to have a zero between a and b. In order to get from positive to negative, it had to pass through zero at some point. And I'm going to choose to make just a little illustration of this just to help clarify, because this math language, if we can put a picture to it, it really does help to explain the concept. So let's say we have a function right here. And right here, let's say this is the point A, f of A. And this right here is the point B, f of B. We know that there has to be a zero somewhere in between those two points. So if here's where x equals A, here's where x equals B, we know there has to be a zero between A and B. And sometimes we will actually literally write an answer to an equation or a solution to the function equaling zero as between A and B. Okay, so it makes sense. If we're at a certain point and our height is positive, and then we move to the right and we have another point where the height is negative, it had to pass through zero somewhere between those x values. All right, we talked about turning points in our introduction. In a polynomial, these represent either a local maximum, that's a peak in our graph, or a local minimum, that's a valley. That's the intended purpose of our introduction, to kind of make those connections. Hey, whenever I'm finding these turning points, it happens to be one of the steepest or like most severe bends in the graph. All right, and then kind of tying into our ideas of making rough sketches of graphs. You know, we have end behavior to work with. We have the touch point versus cross point thing. If a polynomial has degree n, it has at the most n minus 1 turning points. So at most means that we could have a cubic function that only bends, we could have a fourth degree function that only bends once, for instance. But this idea will really help us understand how a function with certain degrees could behave. All right, and I believe this is our last key concept, an even function versus an odd function. A function is even if the height at a positive x input is equal to the height at a negative x input for all the x's in its domain. And how this is shown is a symmetry across the y-axis. And you can see that drawn in the first illustration at the bottom. A function is odd if the height at a negative x input is equal to the negative height with a positive input for all x's in its domain. And these are symmetrical, we say, about the origin. It's like a 180 degree spin on the origin. Or we should be able to trace a point to its reflection and have that connecting segment go through the origin for every single point. So if I picked a point here at some other negative x value, if it were truly an odd function, then connecting that straight line through the origin should lead to the negated point on the right-hand side. All right, our first example. Sketch a graph of the function, use zeros, end behavior, and a small table of values. Now, end behavior. Okay, we need to know how the function is behaving to the far left and the far right. But this is factored out for us. So let's list out where our zeros are occurring, because that's easiest to pull from the factors. Our zeros are occurring where x plus 2 would equal 0, or where x plus 4 would equal 0. So at negative 2 and negative 4. So we'll go ahead and plot those zeros out. And notice that we saw each of those factors twice. That means that those are touch points on the graph. All right, so if the graph is not going to cross through the x-axis, it's going to bounce off of it at those points. Now let's look at the end behavior. What's it doing off to the far right and the far left? Well, if I were to FOIL this back together, I'd just want the leading term. Well, if I were going to do x plus 2 squared, then I would get this polynomial that is x squared And it would be, hopefully we're good with that shortcut, 4x plus 4. And then if I were to square that second factor squared, that second quantity here, I would get x squared plus 8x plus 16. We don't even have to do all of that work. This is just to kind of show you the shortcut. Then if I were going to multiply these two together, I would do first times first to get x to the fourth. There is no other way I can distribute terms to get a power equal to or higher than x to the fourth. So this positive x to the fourth is the leading term if I were to expand out that whole polynomial. And that's all we need. The leading term, we can tell that it's positive and that it has an even degree. So I know that it's rising left and right. And that's going to help us draw our graph. All right, so we have a really good idea about what this graph is doing. Now it's time to use our table of values to get a few points on either side. Well, I want to know what the height is in between. So I want to plug in a negative 3. That means my output is negative 3 plus 2. That's negative 1 squared. And then I've got negative 3 plus 4, that's positive 1 squared. That output is a positive 1. So I know the graph goes through those three points, and then I know it has to rise to the left and the right as we move away from those points. Now, I may want to see what happens at x equals 0, just because that's an easy one to figure out. That gives me 2 squared times 4 squared. Well, that's 4 times 16. That's a height of 64. So it really does climb in a hurry. But we could always fill that table in as much as we needed. That's what we want to accomplish. All right, let's look at number 14. We're going to work through this in very much the same way. So zeros. I know that x equals 4 will be a 0. And I only see that factor once, so I know that that's going to be a cross point. The graph will pass through. And then here, this 2x squared minus 2x plus 1, it does not appear to be factorable, and it is not. So let's do a little bit of work off to the side to see what solutions would I get using quadratic formula. Well, I got opposite of b plus or minus the square root of b squared minus 4ac, 4 times 2, 8, all over 2a. And we can see our discriminant is negative, so we know that it's producing imaginary solutions. So that positive 4 is the only place where our graph will interact with the x-axis. Let's look at n behavior. Well, I've got an x as my lead term and a 2x squared. So if I were to distribute and combine like terms, the leading term would be 2x cubed, the product of those two. And that's telling me that since it's positive with an odd degree, it's going to rise to the right and fall to the left. All right, but with that one point on screen, we're going to have to do a little bit more work to figure out how that graph is bending in between. All right, so let's make an XY table. And let's see what happens when x equals 0. That's always a nice one to choose. I've got 0 minus 4 times 0 minus 0 plus 1. So I got a height of negative 4 for a y-intercept. And I'm tempted to believe that that's how it's going to fall to the left. I know the graph has to cross through, but let's check some values in between here, because I don't know, is that graph rising to the right like this, and is my bend occurring down here? Is it rising to the right so that it's rising here and then making the bend afterwards? I don't know, so I need the table to kind of clarify what that graph is doing. We just don't have enough information yet. So I really just want to see what's happening in the middle there. Let's see what happens when x equals 1. 1 minus 4 times 2 times 1 squared minus 2 times 1 plus 1. At 1, I'm down at negative 3. How about at 2? At 2, then I've got 2 minus 4, 2 times 2 squared, minus 2 times 2, plus 1, that's negative 2 times 5. Oh boy, is that right? 2 times 2 squared, minus 2 times 2. Yeah, that's down at negative 10. Wow, let's see what happens at 3. Pretty confident in my work so far. I don't think I've messed up at all. Hopefully no one's screaming at their TV or computer screen right now. 3 minus 4, 2 times 3 squared, minus 2 times 3, plus 1. That's negative 1 times 13, negative 13. Wow. And just to be sure, because, holy cow, I'm kind of seeing this graph doing this type of thing. It comes way down and then goes up. Let's just check and see what happens at, so we can never be too sure here. Let's see what happens at x equals 5. If I go to x equals 5, hopefully I see something that's way off this screen showing that graph rising very steeply to the right. Positive 1 when I do 5 minus 4. 2 times 5 squared is 50, minus 2 times 5, plus 1. And sure enough, that gives me, 41? So here is a good representation of our graph. It falls off to the left, rises very sharply to the right. And it only has two turning points in it. We said our leading term is 2x cubed, a third degree polynomial, so we should see at most two turns like we have drawn. Very cool. And of course, we could always check by typing this into our calculator, typing the starting function in as y1 in our calculator, and comparing what we've drawn to what shows up in the calculator window. All right, example 2, find all real zeros of the function. Okay, remember, some can be real, some can be imaginary. Now we're tying in the fundamental theorem of algebra as well. If it's not factorable, use your calculator table and the location principle. Very cool concept here. So let's try number 18. Find all real zeros. Well, if I'm looking at where f of x, the height is 0, my only hope at factoring is by grouping. Let's see if we can get that to work. So we can take out x squared, and we get x minus 3. I can take out a negative 4, and I get x minus 3 again. I can factor out that quantity, x minus 3, and I'm left with a difference of squares as my remaining factor. So my zeros are x equals 3, negative 2, and positive 2. And since it's a third degree polynomial, I know with the fundamental theorem that those three real solutions I have, that's all that the graph could have in terms of zeros. All right, let's look at 22. Wow, well, here we can tell by the coefficients that factor by grouping is not necessarily going to work. Okay, there's no way I could get those quantities to match, like we got the x minus 3s up here. There's no way we can get that to work. This is a mistake that students will typically make, and I'll just show you what not to do. Again, this is what not to do. They'll say, oh, four terms I can factor by grouping. I can take x squared out of the first one, and I can take negative 1 out of the second one. So I get x squared minus 1, 2x minus 3, and 32x minus 15 equals 0. No. That does not work. We need the quantities in parentheses to match if we want to factor by grouping. So I do not want to catch you trying that on any of your assignments. This one is not factorable. So unfortunately, or fortunately maybe, we're going to turn to the calculator instead. So let's have a look at this. Pull up the calculator in the Y equals menu. Got to turn it on first. We're going to clear out what we already have entered in the Y equals menu. Go back up to Y1. We've got 2x to the third power minus 3x squared minus 32x minus 15. All right, and now we're going to look at our table to find the real zeros. We know we could see up to three zeros, but here we could even make a little claim that, oh, what does Descartes' rule of signs say? That helps us figure out how many real zeros we could have. I only see one sign change, so I'm anticipating only one real zero. Okay, and let's see what our table says. So second graph will take us to the table. And we do have a zero at x equals 5. Interesting. Very interesting. I do have a zero at x equals negative 3. I'm really surprised to see these whole number zeros showing up because factor by grouping didn't work. Let's take a look at our graph. We still have it set on our previous example. So if we hit zoom 6, we'll go back to that standard 10 by 10 window. And sure enough, we've got a 0 at negative 3, a 0 at positive 5. Oh, that's very interesting. I did not anticipate that. But there's also one happening here that it looks like it's a fraction. So let's go back to our table and see if we can't use the location principle to find out where that's happening. So we have our 0 at negative 3. Ah, right there. You can see between negative 1 and 0, my height went from a positive 12 to a negative 15. So I know somewhere between negative 1 and 0, we have that other solution. Okay, so let's go back and put this in an appropriate answer. So the zeros we found, I'm just going to say via calc table. Okay, notice that as a teacher, what you're telling me right here is not only did you use your calculator, but how did you use it to get the answer? You use the table. X equals, we said positive 5, negative 3, and then somewhere between negative 1 and 0. So that way we've got our three real zeros for a third degree polynomial. There weren't any imaginary ones, which was kind of a surprise to me. And actually, I just want to confirm using Descartes' rule of signs. So if we were to test that for possible positive real zeros, we won't go from positive to negative. That's one sign change. And then my terms are all negative after that. So there's only one possible positive real zero. Hey, that's what we ended up with, one positive real zero. For negative real zeros, we have to look at f of negative x. And that would be negative 2x cubed minus 3x squared plus 32x minus 15. All right, so here we've got negative to negative, negative to positive. There's one sign change, positive to negative. There is a second. So for negative, there could have been two or zero negative real zeros, negative solutions, and we found two of them in our calculator. So again, really neat how it all ties together. We really didn't have to do any of that work in green. It was just I made an assumption early and I wanted to check and see if it really made sense, but I must have just calculated it wrong in my head. Very interesting. Example 3, graph the function, identify the x-intercepts, the local maxima and minima, and the intervals for which the function is increasing and decreasing. There is quite a bit going on. So for this first one, 24, I know that finding the x-intercepts is not going to be too difficult. So I'm going to talk this out, though, because this is a great opportunity to use a calculator. And I know I don't say that very often. I think I even said in an earlier video that using a calculator can be a sign of weakness. But we can also use it to some very good results. So back to y equals. We want negative x to the fourth for y1. Let's clear out what we have. Negative x to the fourth plus 3x. Okay, and if we graph that function out, kind of a weird little like shark fin looking graph, to find the x-intercepts, here we can use either our table. Let's check that first. That will tell us nice clean answers. From our table, we can see that 0, 0 is one of those x-intercepts. And let's look down a little bit further. Oh, okay. Location principle says that somewhere between 1 and 2, I have my height going from positive to negative. So somewhere between 1 and 2, I'm also getting a solution. All right. So to find those x-intercepts, here's where we could actually be a little bit more exact, but we'll use our calculator to do that. Second trace brings up the calculate menu. To find the x-intercepts, what we would look for are the zeros of that function. Okay, and we already know that 0, 0 is 1. So I'm going to move to the right, set my left bound, and then keep moving to the right until I drop down, until I cross the x-axis, set my left bound, and we'll guess something as close as we can using our arrow keys, and it says 1.442. Okay, so we have those intercepts, the local maxima and minima. Well, this graph only shows one peak, and then we're seeing that negative x to the fourth, that falling to the right and left take over. To find the local maximum point, right, there's only one peak or valley there. Again, in the calc menu, we know we're looking for a maximum now. So we're going to choose option 4. I want to toggle to the left of that maximum and hit enter. Toggle to the right of that maximum and hit enter. Again, it asks for a guess. So we will go as close as we can and hit enter one last time. The maximum is 0.908 or 0.909. And then 2.04. All right. Then the last prompt that we have is to identify where that function's increasing and decreasing. Well, it is increasing up until that x value of 0.909. And then it is decreasing thereafter. So the interval from negative infinity to 0.909, and then from 0.909 to positive infinity would be where it's decreasing, where it's losing height. Right, so I know I talked through quite a bit of that, but I would really encourage you to explore this calculate menu. It really will be something that you use a great deal. I'm just going to take a second and pause this recording to input some of those calculator features into this presentation now so we can look back to them. Okay, so I got those graphs put in. Let's go back and answer this question before we move on to number 26. So I just wanted to input some of the stuff from our calculator so I could actually write at the same time. So the x-intercepts, we said the point 0, 0. And then from our calc 0 option, we had 1.442, usually nice to do three decimal places. Those are our x-intercepts. And remember, they're points on the graph, so we should write them as ordered pairs. We had a local maximum at the point 0.909, 2.044. Okay, it is increasing from negative infinity up to that x value of 0.909. And it is decreasing. Once I get past that 0.909, it goes on to positive infinity. And again, these are open intervals because when we get to that actual maximum point, it is neither increasing nor decreasing. So for increasing, decreasing, you will never need square brackets on your intervals. Okay, let's take a look at number 26. So I'm going to go ahead and open up the calculator again. And we'll go to our y equals menu, clear out that function that's currently there. We've got x to the fifth minus 4x cubed. Plus x squared plus 2. Okay, let's take a look at that graph. And wow, this one has quite a few bends in it, quite a few turning points. But take a look at right here in the middle. It looks like a turning point, but the function does not stop decreasing there. It just kind of levels out for just half a heartbeat, and then it keeps going downward. So there are only two turning points, one peak and one valley in this graph. All right, let's start with our x-intercepts. I wonder if there's going to be any that show up in the table. Okay, I've got the point 1, 0. And it looks like it just gets really, really negative as I get further negative with my x's. 1, 0, and then it gets really positive off to the right. But you can also see that between negative 3 and negative 2, I go from a negative height to a positive one, so there's some 0 there. And it looks like that's all I'm seeing. Let's go back to our graph and double check. Somewhere back here, it went from negative to positive. Then we have the point 1, 0, and it looks like I should be seeing something else, right? I should have three x-intercepts showing up. I've got one accounted for right here. I've got one accounted for between negative 3 and negative 2, but it looks like between this 1 and this 2, it's actually dropping down and coming back up in between there. So we're going to have to use calc 0 here to figure that out. So, okay. Calc 0. Let's find out where exactly between negative 3 and negative 2. Okay, negative 2.159. Okay, and I'm just going to take a second and put that into the PowerPoint here. Okay, let's find our next 0. Okay, and we know that we want to be past 1 and not quite to 2. And you see that's 1.747. So again, I'm going to pause the recording, put that into the PowerPoint. Okay, and then now we need our local maxima and minima. So we can see a maximum point is occurring up here and a minimum is occurring down here. So we're going to have to do two separate scans. So I'm going to do calc maximum. I'm going to toggle over. We got to get to the, we want to keep going left past our maximum and toggle to the right, again, going beyond the maximum and hit enter. Okay, and we get this as a result. So I'm going to copy that into the PowerPoint. And now let's do our minimum. So calc minimum is option 3. And we're going to go past that bend because, again, as I come in, it's negative. The height is 2.08, then it goes to 2, then it goes to 2.007. Oh, holy cow, there's a tiny little maximum in there as well. I did not see that happening. All right, well, for my, oh, man, there's a minimum and a maximum. There has to be. Enter. So it's saying 0.2 is a minimum. This scientific notation is telling us it's as close as it can get to 0. So now let's do another calc max. And then it's saying at 1.6866, we're having another tiny little maximum. But again, that's far enough above 2 that we can actually include that. So again, I'll copy that into the PowerPoint. And then lastly, let's find that other minimum that's over here, that elusive one. So calc minimum, left bound, right bound, and here's our minimum. I'm going to pause this again and put that into the PowerPoint, and then we can answer this question finally. Okay, so we've identified all of our x-intercepts and maximum and minimum values. And again, this is why I will sometimes say that using the calculator can be somewhat of a hindrance. It takes a while to run through all these calculations. But as you can tell by the decimal outputs, it's definitely a necessity, excuse me, in some cases. So let's go back to our presentation so I can write. Our function had x-intercepts at negative 2.159, and it had another 0 at 10. Saw that one in our table. And then it had a final x-intercept at 1.747. It had minimum points at the point 02 and another minimum at the point 1.458. It had a maximum at the point negative 1.627. Oh, I don't know why I wrote that as a 0. Come on. It was negative 1.683. The maximum that goes with that x value is 10.474. Then the other maximum that we saw was at 0.169, 2.009. Very tough to spot. All right, so for increasing and decreasing, it is increasing from negative infinity up to that first maximum point at that x value, negative 1.627. And it's also increasing, I'm sorry, I'm going to write over this graph. I hope you're able to read that okay. It's also increasing from, let's see, it had a minimum at 0.2, so at 0 up until 0.169, and then afterwards it's falling. So those are intervals where that function is increasing. Decreasing, going to have a similar setup from my first maximum point, that was an x value of negative 1.627, down to my first minimum point at 0, and then after I get to my other maximum point at 0.169, it continues to fall until I get to that second minimum point, which was 1.458. All right, now I'm also missing something, and I just caught this. It is also increasing one more spot. So it's increasing there, increasing there, and increasing for a little bit there. So I need to say that after that last minimum point, it is increasing, so I need to union that one more time. That last minimum point was at 1.458. Then it continues to increase off to the right to positive infinity. So number 26 was a very, very involved problem. So hopefully you gathered quite a few calculator tips out of that, how to analyze a graph in a calculator. I could not think of a better example to do that. You may need to go back in the video and revisit some of those calculator skills, pause the video here and there. But make sure you understand where I'm getting all these values from, why I wrote increasing the way that I did, decreasing the way that I did, and of course, feel free to ask me any questions. I'm more than happy to answer. That's what I get paid for. All right, example 4. Estimate the coordinates of each turning point and identify each as a local maximum or minimum. Then estimate the real zeros and find the least possible degree of the function. Oh, okay. So, estimating the turning points. Well, I've got one that's right here. That looks like negative 1 1/4. So, negative 5/4. And that looks to be at a height of, well, if this is 10, this would probably be a height of 6. Again, we're just estimating. Okay, the next turning point I see right here, that looks to be, I don't know, about 1/5. And it's at a height of 10, 20, 30, 40, let's say negative 48. The next turning point I see is right here. We're going to go ahead and call that 2. And it has a height of, let's say, 8. Just estimating. Next turning point right here, that looks to be about 2 4/5. Well, 2 4/5 would be 14/5. And that looks to be at a height of, oh, I don't know, negative 3. Okay, so those are my turning points. Identify each as a maximum or a minimum locally. So that first turning point was a maximum. It was a peak in the graph. The next one was a minimum, local minimum. Next one was a local maximum. And finally, we had another local minimum. All right. Next, estimate the real zeros and find the least possible degree of this function. All right, so real zeros. We got one here, 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 and here. All right, so zeros. Estimating that, it looks like negative 1 1/2. Just estimating. Negative 1. Then it looks like positive 1 1/2. And then positive 2 1/2, and then positive 3. Okay, and again, just estimating those coordinates based on the graph. Find the least possible degree of the function. Well, looking at the turns, we have 1 2 3 4 turns. But, I mean, that means that the lowest degree it could have is 5, because it could have at most n minus 1 turns. All right, the zeros, there are 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 zeros. Our fundamental theorem of algebra says that if there are 5 zeros, then we could have a fifth degree polynomial. It could be something greater. It could be a 7th or a 9th or anything else that would agree with that end behavior. But the least possible degree would be 5. 5 zeros and 4 turns, the lowest degree that function could be is a fifth degree polynomial. Example 5, determine whether the function is even, odd, or neither. Now, some students will try and find patterns. I think that's great, but sometimes you'll find a pattern that works one or two times and say, oh, this has to work every single time. That is definitely not true. That is dangerous. We cannot assume that it always works unless it has been proven. So what we're going to do is we're going to run through the different algebraic tests that we have. And there's a progression that we should take. So the first thing we want to do is test for even. And that just means we're going to look at function g with a negative input. And if we get the same exact function as regular g of x, then it works. We're using a variable. We're not testing with a number or anything like that. So g of negative x would be negative 2 times negative x to the 6th plus negative x squared. And I know that, hey, negative things being raised to even powers, the negative sign is absorbed. So g of negative x is really negative 2x to the 6th plus x squared. Hey, that's an exact match to what we started with. G of x is equal to g of negative x. So it's even. Okay, that's our best case scenario. It works on our first test for even. All right, for number 42, let's go through the same progression. Is it even? F of negative x is going to equal negative x to the 5th. Plus 3 times negative x cubed minus negative x. Negative x to the 5th minus 3x cubed. This time the negative signs all stay. Okay, so we don't have a match there. It does not equal our original f of x. Now we test for odd. And that means I look at negative f of x. So I'm distributing a negative to everything that I started with, negative x to the fifth minus 3x cubed plus x, and I'm comparing that to the result of up above. And here we do have an exact match. That's great. Negative f of x is equal to the f of negative x we found in the step above, and that is our definition for an odd function. We've proven it. All right, let's try number 44. Again, test for even first. So again, we're looking at what's f of negative x. That would be positive x cubed minus 2x minus 9. Does not match what we started with. Then we test for odd. Well, that's where I'm looking at negative f of x. Distribute a negative. I get positive x cubed minus 2x plus 9. Again, it doesn't match. So neither of these worked. Our answer is that that function is neither even nor odd. So not a terrible amount of work to do as long as we go test for even, test for odd, and then we make our claim. And our final example, you're making a rectangular box out of a 16 by 20 inch piece of cardboard. You make cuts at the corners and fold up the sides. You want a box that has the maximum volume. Okay, how long should you make the cuts? What is the maximum volume? What are the dimensions of the finished box? Okay, this is a problem that actually, when you get to calculus, you'll see a lot of problems like this where you're trying to maximize a certain amount. But it ties together geometry and algebra so well. I'm glad to see they included this in your Algebra 2 textbook. Well, you can see from the diagram that the base of this box is being set up right here when we cut out these corners of x length in each side. So the volume of this box, based on an input of x, is going to be along the base. We started off with 20 inches, but then we cut off two x's. 20 minus 2x times, well, in the other direction, we had 16 inches to start with, and we cut off 2x. And then once it's all folded up, and we have our box, we have the length and the width of the base accounted for, the height will end up being x units when we fold up those sides. Okay, so our volume as a function of x is going to be 20 minus 2x times 16 minus 2x times x. All right, now this is definitely a calculator problem, and we could definitely FOIL out and combine like terms there, but since it is a calculator allowed problem, let's use our calculator to try and find that maximum. Okay, so in the calculator, we'll fire it up, go to y equals clear out what we had before, and let's type in 20 minus 2x times 16 minus 2x times x. And we can just leave it all FOILed out like that. The calculator will do all the multiplication. Let's graph that out. Okay. And I'm going to do a zoom zero, a zoom fit. And there you can see our graph showing a little bit better. I'm going to change my window to go from, on the x-axis, 0 to 10. Because I can't cut away a negative corner, and then I'll zoom fit. There we go. That looks really nice. Okay. Well, how long should we make the cuts? Well, that's the x value of this maximum. So I'm going to go to calc, option 4 for a maximum, toggle to the left, past the maximum, toggle to the right, past the maximum, and hit enter. And we find that at 2.945, that's where our maximum is occurring along the x-axis. And again, x means how much are we cutting away. Okay. So let me just for a second, I'm going to insert that graph into the PowerPoint. So we have those numbers on hand. All right. So how long should we make the cuts? About 2.945 inches long. What is the maximum volume? Well, this function is the volume based on input. So the y-axis is really representing the volume as an output. So the y value there of 420.110 inches cubed is our maximum volume. What are the dimensions of the finished box? Well, our length of the base is going to be 20 minus 2 times 2.945 by 16 minus 2 times 2.945 by 2.945. And all of those are in inches. And we could clean those up with a calculator, but I think this video is getting long enough at this point. So I'll leave that work to you, the student. Just realize we just need to simplify each of these down to a decimal number and label them each with inches. So many inches by so many inches by so many inches. All right, quite a long section. Here is your assignment for section 4.8. Take some time, really get to know the calculate menu in your calculator. That will be a big benefit to you. And also understand that connection, that function vocabulary that we talked about earlier. Those are going to be things that really, really help you out in the long run.